all of Israel know your name and the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Adonai, who gave us the Torah of truth. Remain standing as we read from Genesis chapter 37, 23 and 24 from the Torah, and then Yoel chapter 4, 9 through 11, or if you're in the King James, it would probably be 3, 9 through 11, and then Luke chapter 10, 18 through 20. So it was that when Yosef arrived to be with his brothers, they stripped off his robe, the long sleeve robe he was wearing, took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty without any water in it. Proclaim this among the nations, prepare for war, rouse the warriors, let all the fighting men approach and attack, hammer your plow blades into swords and your pruning knives into spears, let the weak say, I am strong. Hurry, come, you surrounding nations, gather yourselves together, bring your warriors down, Yehovah.
Kiruzot bikiyom kadshu milchama, hayru hakiborim, yikshu ha'alu kol enshe chame chama, kotu itekem el haraot, umazmore el maich, machalash yomer bi kiborani, ashuva bo ket.
Yeshua said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And remember, I have given you authority so you can trample down snakes and scorpions. Indeed, all the enemy's forces, and you will remain completely unharmed. Nevertheless, don't be glad that the spirits submit to you. Be glad that your names have been written or recorded in heaven.
Vayomer elechem riyati et hasatan. Nafel kabraak min hashamayim, hine hishlati etkem lidrok et nachashim, vikai rabim veal kalbura hayob vekaldaber, lo yizik lakem ait bazo, outsmehu asher niknaim, tachte hikem rakuhot kiim, simhu al asher nikbu.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth, that everlasting life in our midst, and blessed are thou, O Lord, the giver of the Torah. Amen. You may be seated. Turn to someone and say, Happy Hanukkah. Now you may give them a tissue. I just want to speak very short on the Torah portion because I want to give all the time to the children. I know that you've come to hear the children and also me, but and hear the word of the Lord. So the children have the word of the Lord in dance and also in a play, and we're going to read some stories and have a good old time. In Genesis 37, 23 and 24, I was looking at Joseph, and I was looking at in his life, and of course it is a life about not assimilating. It is a life where he tries to keep on track and serving the God of his fathers, and even though the enemy comes in many ways to, you know, get him off the track, we find at the end he really does fulfill the purpose and will of God. When we look at Genesis 37, 23 and 24, it's very interesting that the scripture talks about when he comes with his coat of many colors, that when he gets there, they strip him of his coat, and then they put him in a cistern or a well or a pit that we know of, a pit. And the Torah very specifically says it is a pit without water. You know, when I was looking at that and trying to study that out just for, you know, again, a small amount of time, I looked at Joseph's life, and Joseph had everything going for him. He was the favorite child. How many is the favorite child? He was the baby of the family at that moment. He had a coat of many colors, showing his favoritism of the father. He was spiritually in tune because he was having some dreams and some vision. He was seen into the spiritual realm, where his other brothers didn't seem like they were seeing about anything other than taking care of the things that needed to be taken care of. But apparently, Joseph had this moment where he was so in tune with God that God was revealing to him his future and revealing to him his destiny. So his destiny was ready to unfold. It was ready to unfold with position. It was ready to unfold with power. And it was ready to unfold with authority. But we do know that even though he got the dream of what his life would be like, it was going to take some time before that would manifest, which is the hard part, isn't it? Because we all know, or we feel we know what Adonai wants for our lives, but it's the waiting period that's really hard. It would be great to live in a world of no problems. How many would join that world if we had no problems? How many would sign up for no difficulties? Me too. But what we find is, though we think that a life with no difficulties and no problems brings every day a peaceful day and a calm day, we also know that in order to achieve, in order for the destiny to unfold, in order for the purposes to fulfill, life cannot be calm and life cannot always be peaceful, because there is a struggling that needs to go on in order for us to arrive and become what Yehovah wants us to become. In our lives, these destinies and these purposes are worth struggling for. I woke up this morning, and whatever Yahweh has for me, it's worth struggling for. Whatever I will face this week, it will be worth struggling for. Whatever my destiny is, it will be worth struggling for. And when we look at even Hanukkah, and we understand a little bit about Hanukkah, and I'll just go through a little bit here in just a minute, we understand that to them to regain the temple, it was worth the struggle. If we want something and we want to achieve it, we have to realize that first there will be struggle and effort, then peace, right? Joseph had dreams, and they were powerful dreams of his destiny. He saw his purposes, his purpose in life. And yet, in order for them to be fulfilled, he had to struggle for it. And here he is, a guy who dreams, a guy who has spiritual insight, a guy who can do no wrong in his father's eyes, a guy who walks around with a coat that symbolizes he's the favorite one, correct? And he's going to meet his brothers, not knowing that his brothers were going to propel him to his destiny, not knowing that the dreams that he had needed a pit. And so in order for those dreams to be fulfilled, he had to struggle for them. And anything worth having is worth struggling for. My wife, Gail, she fought for me, and it was worth it. Oh, stop, honey. Stop. Simmer down. She gets carried away when we talk about things like that. You know, the Jewish people were loving Yehovah. They were serving Yehovah. They were doing and going through tradition and custom and motion and service to the temple. And all of a sudden, there was some war that wanted to be waged over the land of Israel. And there was a threat now that's come from the outside to stop their flow, to stop the destiny and purpose of God. But the threat was not only on the outside. There was a threat starting to happen on the inside. And as I was looking at that and reading about this with Hanukkah, I thought to myself, isn't that true about our lives? Don't we have threats on the outside of our lives, but just as powerful are threats on the inside? Don't we have these things coming from the outside that sometimes we think we can combat? And then those things that come from the inside seem to be harder to struggle against. And when we look at this, we have this very powerful understanding that the influence of the Hellenists came. And people, these Hellenists were people who accepted idol worship. They were people who were Caesarian and followed the Caesarian way of life. And that seemed to be increasing. And when we look at today's traditional Christianity and today's people as a whole, we find that more people want to just go with the way of the world, go with the way of the culture, go with whatever is the new thing today, and they want to serve God any way they want to serve God. That's the threat within. Because if we're not careful, we will follow the same thing because it's easier. And many of the Jewish people saw the danger, and they opposed this influence on this holy land. And then, of course, we know the story. Antioch IV began to reign over Syria. They called him Epiphanes, which means the God's beloved. And he was desiring to unify his kingdom through the medium of a common religion and a culture. Somewhat the same today. Can't we all just get along, and can't we all just coexist, and can't we all just serve our gods and just be okay? He removed the high priest, replacing with someone who loved the Greek culture, a member of the Hellenistic party, and we start seeing what happens. The defilement of the temple. The forbidding of Jewish worship. The Torah scrolls confiscated, burned. Sabbath rest, circumcision, dietary laws prohibited under penalty of death. Thousands sacrificed their lives for simply refusing to assimilate to the culture. You can feel the pressure, even today. After a series of battles, simple story of Hanukkah is a group rose up and a group conquered and won. It's called victory. They had something worth fighting for even though it seemed all was lost, they had something worth fighting for. I believe this nation was worth fighting for. I believe your family is worth fighting for. I believe your marriage is worth fighting for. I believe your children are worth fighting for. I believe these children are worth fighting for. I believe our existence and our culture and our way of worship, our serving the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, is worth fighting for. And if it even means stand against culture and society at a price that we don't want to pay, it's still worth the fight. They had something worth fighting for, even though it seemed all was lost. Well, that's wonderful, but what has to do with Joseph? We left him in a pit. What's that got to do with anything? Because if I go back to Genesis chapter 37, verse 24, we find that Joseph's brothers sell him as a slave, but before they throw him in a pit, the scripture says the pit was empty and there was no water in it. It's understandable that if the pit is empty, it's obvious there's no water in it. So what is Yehovah trying to tell us? Because although there's no water, when there's a dry place, especially in a desert place, what shows up? Scorpions, snakes, right? So I was thinking, you know, we live in a day and age where we have so much information. Right now, some of you are going very nervous because you know your phone's near you and you're trying to figure out whether you're getting messages. We're so attached to this, keeping our minds so busy all the time. I've said it before, even as we preach or we're in service, you know, if it gets quiet and there's a moment of silence, we get paranoid if the silence is more than 2 seconds. Because we're so used to everything just coming in at a rapid rate. And so here is Joseph, who has dreams and power and understanding position and destiny. The word of God is in his life. Torah is in his life. He's loving God, and he comes to the edge, and he's put into a pit. And when he gets into the pit, the word tells us there's no water. You know, the mind and the heart of man are never empty. If there is no life, nourishing water, there will always be snakes and scorpions. Our hearts and minds are not empty vacuums. They quickly fill up. You know, as we look at our children over here to my left and also in front and all around, what you don't realize, if you don't allow the Word of God to be filled into their brains and their hearts, something will fill their brains and their hearts. And it will be snakes and scorpions. It will be exactly what you don't want them to have. And the idle brain, the lack of movement in the Word of God, if you're not careful, if we've not trained them in the way they should go, if we're not careful, there are loads of information that wants to come and change their venue and change their path and change their destiny. So we looked at this pit with no maim, no water. We know that water, when we look in go through the Torah, water refers to the Torah, Maim Haim, and its nourishing teachings. One of the greatest things about Joseph that you can learn is that before he gets into a pit, he has enough life-sustaining water to sustain him through a pit of dry scorpion snake field. dust. To fill our minds and hearts with this word leaves no empty spaces for negativity and this world to creep into. It's the empty spaces where the world comes. The life-sustaining Mayim keeps the scorpions out. Now, I was looking at this, and I, you know, I was thinking and studying just a little bit, and again, trying to condense things. It's hard when you're a preacher to condense things because you want to say everything that you bring into your brain. So even right now, I'm condensing and shifting and moving and thinking, man, I'll put that later. While Yosef was in the pit, he had to make sure his heart and his mind was filled with Yehovah's word so that the scorpions, which is life or society or his feelings, would not invade his heart and mind and change his direction. The pit is to propel us, but if we don't prepare ourselves before the pit can change our direction. The pit was used to propel him to the place of destiny. It was to propel him to the place where his dream would be fulfilled. But before he got to the pit, he had to make sure that he had water, enough ma'im haim, enough life-nourishing water. Because when he got to the pit, and all of us can testify, it's easy to worship when you're in a place where everyone's worshiping. It's easy to drink from the fountain when the fountain is flowing. It's easy to say amen, hallelujah, when everyone is amen and hallelujah. But when you arrive to the place where you're in a pit and there's nothing there and there is no water and the only thing that there is your feelings and society and culture and scorpions and snakes, then you have a choice to make. It's easy not to assimilate when you're around people who refuse to assimilate. It's harder to not assimilate when you're around people who are not serving the same Yahweh you're serving. So his destiny, his purpose, the will of Yahweh in his life, the Torah, his halakha, was worth struggling for. It was worth a pit experience. And the only thing that he had in the pit, you know, you don't always have your Bible to carry around with you. And I don't know about you, but sometimes through testing and trials, sometimes my mind goes blank when it wants to find a scripture. Depending on the intenseness of the heat, depending on the intenseness of the pit, if I'm not careful, what do I want to focus on? I'm not looking for the word. I'm not looking for what it says in the Brit Kadashah, what it says in the Torah. I'm looking, if I'm not careful, at the pit and what's in the pit that is dangerous to me. But at the same time, instead of focusing on the word of God that can wash away that dryness and wash away the scorpions and snakes, I focus on the scorpions and snake. And the more I focus on the scorpions and snake, the more I give credence to it. See, the assimilation, why we celebrate Hanukkah is because even though I read it to you very quickly, it wasn't a quick thing. You know, people were just slowly assimilating and then slowly assimilating. You slowly forget, and you slowly do what you want, and you slowly leave this out, and you slowly choose this over this, and you slowly do this, and all of a sudden what you didn't realize was when you're thrown into a pit, you can hardly escape it. Because of the snakes and the scorpions. We celebrate Hanukkah because our lifestyle, our belief, our tradition, our Torah, Yahuwah, is worth fighting for. We must fight against the scorpions of our hearts and minds because they are there. In Luke chapter 10, we read it, and I was encouraged when I read it because it gave me new understanding when I was relating to Yosef in a pit. Yeshua said to them, I saw Satan falling like lightning from heaven. Remember, I have given you authority so you can trample down what? Snakes and scorpions. Indeed, all the enemy's forces. Now, of course, I imagine, you know, are they literal or are they spiritual? Yes. And I can imagine that as we're going forth, because if you read the story before, he's sending them out, right? He's sending them out to proclaim the good news. He's sending them out to preach the gospel. He's sending them out to those who will hear. And what he's saying is when you go out into the world, you need to be careful because Satan has fallen from heaven, which means he has some influence in your life if you're not careful. And he will come in moments when the enemy comes against you. Listen, if we all move together as a unit, it's very powerful. If you're out there by yourself, it's a little bit scary. And those snakes and those scorpions are there, but you can trample them. You don't have to worry about it. When you're on a high moment, when you're in a victorious moment, when you're wearing your coat of many colors, you can give him praise. And when it's stripped from you and you're in your pit and the snakes and the scorpions are looking at you, you can still give him praise because your destiny will be fulfilled. As long as you know that it's worth the fight. Most of us try to run from scorpions and snakes. But if you're in a pit, that's not going to be possible. How do I know that Yosef won over that? Because I read the end of the book, didn't you? And the fulfillment of the destiny of Jehoiada's life was there in his life. And the scorpions and the snakes and the lack of water at a time when he could have used it. He had enough in him. He had enough in him to sustain him. You can't go without Mayim Haim very long, without dehydration. And dehydration causes many things to happen to your body, right? Breaks it down. Makes you look older. Continual lack of it will cause death. Why do we go so long without Mayim Haim? And then when we end up in a pit, we struggle against it because we didn't have enough in us to sustain us through the pit moment. And then we're grabbing for it. I don't know about you, but sometimes I can hear him playing. And clear, and he's speaking, and I can feel his movement, and I like that. And then there are times I don't know where he went. I don't hear a thing. But the only thing I know is that he has to still be there, right? And at that moment, I pull from the reservoir that I have had. That moment I pull from what I need because it is dusty. And then I start looking around and there's that little scorpion. And then I look over there and there's that snake. And if I'm not careful, I will be pulled in because of my lack of Mayim Haim. The story of Hanukkah is about some people who only drank when they wanted. And then society, Greek, Caesarean life came in, and they kind of went with the flow. And then there was a group of people who kept drinking from the Mayim Haim. And what happened was, when everything started to go backwards, something rose up in them. Kind of like an anger, Sister Norma, but a positive one. An anger that said, we will not let this happen. We must fight because it's worth fighting for. You sit here because he is worth fighting for. The destiny and the purpose that Yehovah has for you. Amen? Joseph made it out of the pit because he had enough water in him to sustain him through dry places. Please make sure you have a reservoir that will make sure that you will make it through dry places, because every single one of us will have pit and slavery in our lives and lies in our lives and betrayal in our lives and prison in our lives, right? Before you ever have your destiny unfold. And if you don't learn anything, learn this from Joseph. Make sure you have enough living water, because you never know when the pit's coming. He was skipping to go see his brothers with some food. Skipping and letting his coat wave in the wind. Thinking to himself, oh, the Ruach is good to me. I had another dream. Can't wait to tell my people. Never thinking that, oh, I'm headed for trouble. Oh, I'm headed for a pit. He just was running, excited, young man. And he got there. He probably went there and started twirling. And as he twirled and they got around, that coat went into the air. They probably grabbed that coat, and that's when they ripped it right from him. Shock of his life. And then thrown in a pit. It would be nice if God sent us a letter. Dear Jeffrey, in 1 week you will go through this. Prepare yourself. Drink plenty of water. But he doesn't. I just need to be prepared. Because one day I'm worshiping on a mountaintop, and the next day I fell in a hole, and it took me way down deep. But when I landed, what did I have inside me? Ma'im haim. Enough living water to sustain me. To he who helps cometh, for he is my refuge. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, children, we're very excited to see what you got. Amen? And are we dancing first or play? Doing the play first? Or you want to dance first? Y'all didn't invite me to dance. I don't know why, but I won't hold that against you. I know why they didn't invite you. I've seen you dance.
Thank you. family are preparing to celebrate the Feast of Dedication. Mary recently became engaged to a carpenter. His name is Joseph. There is much excitement. This may be the last feast she will celebrate in the home with her mother and father before she becomes a bride. An older woman calls everyone together to tell the story of the Maccabee.
Come on, kids, we're going to tell the story of the Maccabees. Mary, can you go get the scroll, please? A long time ago, there was an evil ruler named Antiochus. He wanted the people of Israel to worship him and his false gods. He forbid them from worshiping and serving the one true God, Yahweh. One day, Matthias and his five sons saw these soldiers of this evil ruler destroying the temple. They couldn't fight it. They couldn't stand it no longer, and they fought back. They led the rebellion against this evil king. One of the greatest leaders was Judas the Maccabee. After 3 years, they defeated this evil. They set about cleaning the temple for worship. As they prepared for this rededication of the temple, they were dismayed to find there was only one small bottle of holy oil to light the menorah. And this will last only one night, and it'll take 8 days to prepare more. The dedication of the temple was so important, they decided they could not wait. They used up this one bottle in the menorah miraculously. It lasted the 8 days, and it never went out. That's why today we gather to celebrate the Feast of Dedication and the miracle Yah did for his people. Mary, will you say the prayers and light the first night candles?
Praise are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has sanctified us with commandments and commanded us to light the Hanukkah candles. Praise are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has performed miracles for our ancestors in those days and this season. Praise are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has granted us life sustenance and enabled us to reach this season.
Time to go to sleep. Mary, Mary, you are highly favored. You will give birth to the Messiah. Holy Spirit
will overshadow you.
Spirit will overshadow you, and you will have a son, and his name will be Emmanuel. Yah is with us, and he will save your people and those who come to believe in him.
That Yah's will be done.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
We got to get a children's credit. Sometimes I get nervous too. So I know how it is. The children are going to come up and tell us, or tell you all what they are thankful for. But before they come up, I want to thank God for Jesus. I want to thank him for waking me up in the mornings. And when I wake up, I got the activities of my limb. I can walk, I can talk, and I can move. And all I can say is thank you, Jesus. And God is good all the time. Amen? Okay, children.
I'm thankful for my family, friends, food, water, and Yah.
I'm thankful for my food, my water, my family, my friends, and my church.
I'm thankful for my food and my water and Yah.
I'm thankful for my food, my water, and my family.
I'm thankful for my family and friends.
Now they're going to share how they can shine their light for God.
I want to dance and sing for Yah and help anyone in need.
I want to dance and sing for Yeshua, and I want to help people and animals.
I want to dance and sing and be a missionary.
I want to dance and sing and help animals.
I want to dance and sing and be a missionary and help anyone in need, too.
Amen. Amen. Let's give the church a big hand. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Of days long ago,
one for each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. Oh Hanukkah, come light the menorah, let's have a party, we'll all dance the horror. Gather round the table, we'll give you a treat, sip all the need to play with the lock, kiss to eat. And while we are playing, the candles are burning, each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. Of days long ago, one for each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. One for each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago.
Woo! Woo! Is that it? All right, girls, dancer, come up here. The ones that just dance, come here. Make a circle. Like you're going to dance. Turn the lights up just a little bit. Okay, that's a lot. I meant those lights I can see out there. Okay, I need, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 volunteers. I don't need water. Oh, thank you, though. Come on, another man. Yes, come on. Thank you. That's 2. Isaiah, thank you for volunteering. Praise the Lord. Amen. And Uncle Brian, come on, Uncle Brian. Amen. All right, Jody, come on. Get in between. They're going to teach you how to dance. Anyone else?
Way to go, Ben. Way to go, Ben.
Hold on. We need someone around. We got someone. Get in there. Yeah. Let's see. Jody, come right here. So we have a spot. We have a spot. We have a spot. Okay. Come on. All right. We got to watch them. All right. Teach them how to do it. Okay. Here we go. Hit the music. Do the best you can. Here we go.
Oh, Hanukkah. Oh, Hanukkah. Shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. One for each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. Oh, Hanukkah, oh, Hanukkah, come light the menorah. Let's have a party, we'll all dance the horror. Gather round the table, we'll give you a treat. Sip all the knit to play with the lock, kiss to eat. And while we are playing, are burning low. One for each night they shed a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. Of days long ago. One for each night they shared a sweet light to remind us of days long ago. One for each night they shared a sweet light to remind us of days long ago.
Hey! Woo! Great job. Great job. Rest up because some more people are going to do it. Hallelujah. All right, children, come on. Hang with that. Come on over here. Amen. It's story time. All children come, whether you're young or old. If you're too old, I can't. If you go down, I can't get you up. So you're on your own. Do what? No, it's still there. In a minute. Not right now. All right, remember last year we told a story. What story did we tell you? The Minch on the Bench. So let me read that real quick because I'm going to tell you about another hero, okay? Because this is the hero, one of the heroes of Hanukkah. And if anyone has reading glasses, I might need them. Look at you all young, like no one has reading glasses. So this one is about, what was his name? Do you all remember? Pastor? No, it wasn't Pastor. When I put these on, I want you all to be excited. Whose are these? Chuck, you blind? Thank you, Chuck. All right, let's look. Everyone, I don't know if I can do that. They're just a little bit more. Thomas and Laura, we're very laid back. If you can tell, we're just, let's see what happens. Oh, they're better. And you all still not blurry. Everyone knows the story of the Maccabees and how they led the Jews to freedom, but nobody knows about the unsung hero of Hanukkah, Moshe the Minch. So let me share the story. How many know what a minch is?
It's a wise person.
It's a wise person. Well, actually, let me see that, Moshe. Can you give it to Charity? That looks pretty good, right? Well, let's all, on the count of three, let's yell for Moshe to come. Ready? One, two, three. Moshe! Oh, well, Lord, here comes Moshe right now. Everybody, look at Moshe. Moshe, have a seat beside that girl right there. They kind of look alike. Judah and the Maccabees returned to the temple and celebrated their victory against the Greeks. And at the end of the night, when they were ready to go to bed, they realized that they only had enough oil for how many nights? One night. They only had enough oil for one night, but the oil lasted for eight. A friendly voice replied from the back of the temple, "I will stay up and watch the lights and let you know if it goes out. You and the others get some rest." That's so very nice of you. Judah said, "Thank you. What is your name, friend?" And the man replied, "My name is..." I was going to let him speak. He can speak.
Moshe.
"And I will be happy to sit on this bench and watch over the temple." "And Moshe, you're a mensch," Judah said. "A mensch on a bench." And the children laughed. And so the Maccabees, their families, and the rest of the congregation went to sleep, and Moshe sat and watched over the light. And to Moshe's amazement, the light stayed lit all night. In the morning, everyone was amazed that the light was still lit, and surely this little bit of oil could not last two nights. But sure enough, on the second night, the lights remained lit, and Moshe the Mensch watched over the temple. On the third day, when the Maccabees went to work, Moshe played with the children. The children were bored and had only clay to play with. They asked Moshe to make up games for them. So Moshe wrote symbols on the clay, spun it around, and the kids began to play what? On the third night, just like the second night, Moshe again watched the lights, and they stayed lit and shone bright. And on the fourth day, the children wanted to thank Moshe for playing with them, so they made special presents for him, wrapped them, and let him open them in front of them. Oy, how Moshe smiled. Did y'all bring presents for Moshe?
No.
Oh, he's still smiling. On the fourth night, Moshe the Mensch watched over everyone, and the lights remained. And on that fifth night, the children were tired of eating the same boring foods for days in a row and asked Moshe to make them a treat. So Moshe made his famous lakkas. What's a lakka?
A potato pancake.
Filled up everyone's bellies and made everyone smile. What a mensch. On the fifth night, Moshe again watched as the light shone bright on the Jews of the temple. Surely it could not last six nights. And on the sixth day, the Jewish people of the temple knew that something special was happening. They joined together and celebrated with the songs, just like we still do to this day. They probably sung Hanukkah, Hanukkah. We're going to see some more adults. How many would like some of all the adults to come dance with you?
Yeah.
That's going to be great. Security, lock the doors. I feel movement. On the sixth night, Moshe watched as the light shone bright, and the Jewish people watched with him as the miracle of Yahuwah shone before them. On the seventh day, the Sabbath, the Jews rested. Tired from staying up all night, Moshe rested too. You sleeping? Okay. The kids watched the lights and made sure they did not go out, and the oil continued to burn. On the seventh night, the miracle of lights continued, and Moshe the Mensch smiled as he knew that Yehovah was watching out for his people. And on the eighth day, the Jews celebrated as the miracle continued. Moshe snuck away, and when nobody was looking, filled everyone's pockets with coins made of candy called gelt, and everyone was so happy. What a mensch. How you all doing? And on the eighth night, after the oil had lasted for 8 long days. How many days?
8
long days. More oil arrived at the temple, and the Jews, now free, celebrated and knew that Yahuwah had sent them a sign. So they were waiting for 8 days for more oil to show up. Which brings me to my next hero. Hannah, can I see Hannah? Hannah. On the count of three, let's call for Hannah. 1, 2, 3. Hannah! Let's see what Hannah looks like after years of work. Hannah! Hannah looks great with a slingshot. She's ready to hurt anyone. Sure. You want her to try? Later. Let's look at Hannah. See, she's ready to go. Let's look at Hannah. Hannah Maccabee was mad. Moshe, have you ever seen Hannah Maccabee mad? Moshe, you're a rabbi. Rabbis don't lie. Her cousins had headed off to face the Greeks and defend the Jewish people, and here she was sitting around the great temple, not allowed to help. Isn't that sad when you can think you can do something and you're not allowed to help? That makes you mad, doesn't it? She looked around the temple, caught the eye of her great uncle Moshe, a mensch in every sense of the word. He was watching over the children. His eyes kept drifting to the dwindling reservoirs of oil, and soon there would only be enough for one night. Her father, Jacob, had struck out days ago to find more oil for the great temple, and Hannah was getting worried, and she asked her mother if she could set off after him, but her mother said the road was no place for a young Jewish girl. But how many know girls can do stuff? Right? Can girls do stuff? Like cook and clean? Hold on, you're not doing that stuff? All young men hear her. Hear her well, people. Hannah knew her mother was wrong, and the roads were exactly the place for her. Hannah was smart. You all smart?
Yeah.
She was strong. Anyone strong? And she had a heart filled with love. And nothing. You have love? A heart full of love? You weren't so excited about having a heart full of love. So how many are strong?
Many.
How many are smart?
Many.
And how many have a heart full of love?
Many.
Good answer. But not you, because you won't clean or do anything. Nothing could stand in her way, and the world was about to find that out, because Hannah would be a hero. Hannah sat out on the road, walked for hours and hours, following the path of her father's cart. She got to a fork in the road and saw tracks leading off to the right and tracks leading off to the left. Which way should she go?
Straight.
Straight. Mm-hmm. Listen well. She doesn't do good with directions. She studied the tracks, saw the ones on the right were dug deep into the ground, and those on the left were just slightly marking the ground. So she set it off to the place that the... Oh, hold on a minute. He headed off to get oil in an empty cart, thought Hannah. A heavy cart would leave deep tracks, and his light cart would not. And off to the left, Hannah went. So which way should she go, right or left?
Yeah.
I'm glad you got that out of all that. With little food in her pockets. And we know how much you all like food, because you said, I am thankful for what?
Food.
Food. Did you all know that on the days of Hanukkah, we fast? No, not I fast. Children fast. Did you know that? And then all the adults eat the candy and the jelly donuts. I have it written in the book. Okay. With little food in her pockets, Hannah's stomach started to rumble. She stopped by. Is this on tape? She stopped by the side of the road to eat what little food she had and to take just a little break. No sooner had she sat down than an old woman came along the path. Hannah, even the mensch, just like her uncle Moses, offered to share her food with the old woman Rachel. The two shared a meal, talked about their families, and headed along the same path to cross over the great mountain. Once at the bottom of the mountain, there was a cart that had only space for one more person to carry to the other side, and Hannah stood in shocked silence as the last spot was filled by her new friend Rachel. Rachel turned and saw Hannah and said, "Come along, Hannah." She replied that she had no money and there was no room on the cart. Rachel laughed and she told one of the men to make room for Hannah and lifted her in the cart. I do know something. What do you want to tell me? That's lit, isn't it? It's not lit. It fell off.
While I was dancing?
Well, we'll find it and it'll be a miracle. "This is my cart," said Rachel, "and as there is always room in our hearts for more kindness, there is always room for one more next to me." After crossing the mountain in the cart, waving goodbye to her new friend, Hannah headed off to find her father, and it was almost dark when she came upon a campfire and saw her father sitting by the fire with the oil in his cart. Happened. She started to call to him when she noticed the Greek soldier standing over him. He had been captured. So moving quietly through the woods, Hannah planned her next move. Out of her bag, she took her slingshot. She had always been the best in the temple with it. And with a cry, Hannah yelled, "Level the hammer!" And the war cry of the Maccabees in a single shot flew into the night. Abraham, open up your mouth. That was your time. You almost missed it. Thump! The soldier fell. And Hannah ran and untied her father. Jacob looked at Hannah with astonishment and said, "Hannah Maccabee, you are a sight. You are my little hero. And with a giant hug, the two jumped into the cart filled with oil, and the two set back off to the great temple. It had been a long 8 days on the road when Hannah returned. Her great-uncle Moshe sat on the bench playing dreidel with the children as the cart came into the temple, and her cousin Judah greeted her with an open arms, and it was a true miracle. The oil had lasted 8 wonderful days in the great temple, and Yehovah had watched out for all the Jewish people. Hannah wondered just how long Yehovah would have kept the oil burning to watch out for his people. But thanks to her heroics, the world would never need to find out. And that is the story of Hannah the Hanukkah hero, the mensch who got off the bench to help the Jewish people and teach the world the difference a single person can make. So do you know that you can make a difference in this world? No matter how old or how young you are, if you let Yehovah guide your life and let the Spirit of God open up your life and you be obedient to him, you will do great and mighty things because we believe in you. Look at those people out there. They believe in you. And the next time you're going through something and you need to call on God, you just yell, "Level the hammer!" All right, can you do that?
Level!
On the count of three, ready? One. If you're not cleaning, you're not going before me. Now get go watch with me. Let me do the count and you do the yelling, all right? Okay? Okay. Two things. She's not cleaning and she's not obedient. One, to? Yeah, you too. You're on the list now. One, two, three. Level the hammer. Right. All right. Let's get up and get in a circle and go grab an adult. Get in a circle. Moshe and Hannah, you might want to back off a little. Back a little. You might get ran right over, sister and brother. Get in a circle. Okay, I'm coming. Whose glasses were these?
These were Chuck's.
Wayne's with a wire frame. Okay. Are we here? Any other adult would like to join us, even though you weren't chosen because we didn't have enough children? Come on. Come on. Spread out a little bit. Hallelujah. Children, come on up. We can pray for over you. Thank you, Moshe. Thank you, Moshe and Hannah. Huh? All right, congregation, come. Let's pray over these children. Cindy, sign up. Here we go. That box that has been in your daddy's room on the table. All right, we got children. We all got children. We all got children. Okay, let's pray. Hallelujah. Everyone else, lift your hands toward the children. Father, we thank you in the name of Yeshua for all these children represented underneath this prayer shawl. We ask, God, that we consecrate them and dedicate them unto you for the service of the kingdom. We thank you, Lord, that they will come to the saving knowledge of Yeshua as their Messiah. Walk out your ways, follow the Torah, and be obedient to your will and to your way. Father, anoint them, use them for your kingdom. Let them be a generation that roars, level the hammer, and Father, Lord, refuses to assimilate to the world. We give you praise as we lift them up to you. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen and amen. Lift up your hands, children, everyone in the congregation, to receive the priestly blessing. Yehovah, he who exists, kneel before you, presenting gifts, and will guard you with a hedge of protection. Yehovah, he who exists, will illuminate the wholeness of his being towards you, bringing order. He will provide you with love, sustenance, and friendship. Yehovah, he who exists, will lift up wholeness of being, look upon you. He will set in place all you need to be, whole and complete. May Yehovah grant all the desires of our hearts, fulfill all our purposes and all our petitions. May Yehovah hear from heaven, quickly answer all our requests, save us in the day of adversity. And in the name of Yeshua the Messiah, defend us from our enemies, from poverty, and from bondage. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. We'll see you in the fellowship hall. And just...